Christ.
Amen.
Let's say amen today.
Amen.
We're going to quote Psalm number 18. That's what I wanted to do. And the longest psalm of the psalm. I think if my memory serves me correctly, the longest chapter in the Bible. We're going to be reading a section out of the psalm, hoping for the duration of this series. We're beginning a new series today entitled What Jesus Believed About the Scriptures. And so I think it's most appropriate that we read the psalm that is dedicated. It is a praise of God for his word. And it's a unique psalm. Every verse in this psalm starts off with
Hebrew alphabet.
A letter in the Hebrew alphabet, so it's an alliterated psalm. And so when we're reading this in the Hebrew, it all starts off with the first letter, for instance, 1 through 8, first letter of the Hebrew alphabet, Aleph, next one, Beth. And so it is uniquely written.
Amen.
To the Hebrew mind. This would have been an easy way for the Hebrews to remember this psalm. So it's a unique psalm, and it seems to say it's written so uniquely. It's written so the Hebrews could memorize it, and it's about the Word of God. So it seems, well, it doesn't seem as though God wanted his people to know these things about his Word. So most appropriate, because we're going to begin talking today about what Jesus thought about the Scriptures. So we're going to be reading through this psalm. Hopefully it'll last us throughout the series, because I have quite a bit to say.
Amen.
About what Jesus believed.
Amen.
About the Holy Scriptures. Let's continue to pray for our brothers and sisters in the Lord. Continue to pray for Deacon Scott and his recovery. He's back in Canton, have mercy, and coming along. So get an opportunity, you can stop by and see him, call him. I'm sure it'll be most appreciated. Let's pray for some still need employment, others going through other and diverse things. And so let us pray for one another.
Amen.
So let's go to this psalm. Psalm number 119. It's really meditations and prayers to God because of the word of the Lord. So let's just read this first one together. Out. Verse 1.
How blessed are those who wait in plans, who walk in the law of the Lord. How blessed are those who observe his testimonies, who seek him with all their heart. They also do not unrighteousness, they walk in his ways. You have ordained your precepts that we should keep them diligently. Oh, that my ways may be established to keep your statutes. Then I shall not be ashamed when I look upon all your commandments. I shall be thanking you with all my heart when I remember your righteous judgments. I shall keep your statutes. Do not forsake me utterly.
Our gracious Heavenly Father, we praise you and thank you for this day. Even on this cold, snowy day, Lord, we thank you and praise you. We realize it's another day that you have made, and we are going to rejoice, and we are going to be glad in it, and we're going to give God the best that we can during this time of worship and praise. Lord, we want you to know that we think you're an awesome and a great God.
Yes.
And Lord, we want to do all that we do in glory to you.
Yes.
Lord, we want to be obedient to you and always fulfill that great commission, and that is preach the gospel to every created thing, every being, every person. The gospel is very simple. Jesus died for our sins according to the scriptures. He was buried and he rose again on the third day. Salvation is by grace through faith in the cross of Jesus Christ. It is through repentance of our sin and faith in Jesus Christ. If any are to be saved, it is only through that gospel. Lord, we pray for the many needs that exist today. Lord, you know exactly what they are. Lord, meet those needs according to your way, according to your will. Lord, we pray for our country. We pray for our land. Lord, thank you, pray for all things today. We pray in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, John 1, 6 through 17. I will read the even verses, you will read the odd, and we'll read verse 17 together. Then came a man sent from God, whose name was John.
He came as a witness to testify about the light, so that all might believe through him.
He was not the light, but he came to testify about the light.
There was a true light which shone into the world, and lightens every man.
He was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him.
He came to his own, and those who were his own did not receive him.
But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, even to those who believe in his name.
Who were born not of blood, nor of the will of flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God.
And the Word became flesh, and dwelt among us, and we saw his glory, glory as of the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth.
John testified about him and cried out, saying, this was he of whom I said, he who comes after me has a higher rank than I, for he existed before me.
For of his fullness we have all received, and grace upon grace. Verse 17 together.
For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth were realized through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Good morning, family.
Good morning.
Our next song is in our hymnal. It is found on page 251 of our hymnal. It came upon a midnight year. It says that in Luke chapter 2, verse 9, an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. Luke chapter 2, verse 9.
To touch their hearts.
time to look at her adult for her to come forward.
Thank you.
Glory to God. Amen. As we celebrate this Christmas season, let us remember it's all about our God.
Amen.
He has come to save us from our sins.
Amen.
So if you want a gift this year, accept Jesus. It's the greatest gift.
Amen.
Let us all stand this morning as we sing our last worship song, page 278. And the heavenly host appeared with the angel. Praise God.
In this text, we see Jesus really quoting get it started. And it's very important series of sermons. I don't know how long I'm going to be here, but because it is an extensive subject, I'm going to take as long as it takes.
Take your time. Take your time.
And that will be, I can't tell you. Matthew 4, 1 through 11, I'll begin reading in verse 1. And I'll read through 7, then I'll let you do 8, 9, 10, and 11. And then we'll start this journey in Jesus and the scriptures. The word of the Lord says, then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And after he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he then became hungry. And the tempter came and said to him, if you are the Son of God, command that these stones become bread. But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Then the devil took him into the holy city and had him stand on the pinnacle of the temple. He said to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. Jesus said to him, on the other hand, it is written, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test. 8 through 11, read.
Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, all these things I will give you if you fall down and worship me. Then Jesus said to him, go, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God and serve him only. And the devil left him, and behold, the angels came and began to minister to him.
Did God people say amen?
Amen.
It is written. It is written. It is written. And then he quotes the written scriptures, the word of God. So that sort of gets us going. Because this morning I'm going to begin a series of sermons concerning Jesus and the scriptures. To be more specific, I'm going to be teaching concerning Jesus' view of the scriptures, of what Jesus believed to be true concerning the scriptures. The goal of this series is for us to develop the same view as Jesus concerning the scriptures, or the book we call the Bible. But it is also my hope that we will all develop a greater trust in the scriptures, which further strengthens our belief in the doctrine of sola scriptura, for scripture alone. And what this means is the scriptures alone are the highest authority in all matters concerning salvation, doctrine, the necessary instruction to live the Christian life in fellowship with God. And so we believe, or at least I believe, that the scriptures are sufficient. I believe in sola scriptura, I believe in scripture alone. And hopefully, after we begin to see how Jesus viewed the scriptures, it will further enforce your belief in that. If that's not your belief, we hope that you will be converted to that view.
Amen.
Scripture alone. Amen. All right, why is it important that we believers develop an adequate understanding concerning what Jesus believed to be true concerning the scriptures? Why is it important that we as believers, Christians, have an adequate understanding in regards to what our Savior, our Lord, believed to be true concerning the scriptures? Well, it is important that we understand what Jesus believed to be true concerning the scriptures for numerous reasons, inclusive of the following, letter A. What Jesus believed to be true concerning the scriptures is the only view that counts.
Amen.
Can I say that again?
Yes, sir.
What Jesus believed to be true concerning the scriptures is the only view which counts.
Amen.
This is true of all, no matter who it may be, pastors, theologians, scholars, bishops, popes, cardinals, priests, so-called modern-day apostles and prophets, the layman or the person in the pew, and also the unredeemed. Amongst all of those, the only view that counts is what Jesus believed to be true. Amen. And I say, what Jesus believed to be true concerning the scriptures is the only view which counts because of who Jesus is.
Amen.
When we speak of who Jesus is, all the reliable historical evidence reveals Jesus was God incarnate. Mm-hmm. Or he was God in human flesh.
Yes, sir.
Or perfect God, perfect man. He was all that makes God God, yet also a perfect, sinless human being. I cannot go into any detailed analysis of all the evidence that Jesus is God in human flesh. This series is not on Christology, but it is on the Lord's view of Scripture. So I can't go into a detailed analysis of why all the evidence says Jesus is God in human flesh, but let me just give you a few. Number one, Jesus clearly claimed to be God. When I say Jesus claimed to be God, what I mean is he claimed to be equal with the Father in all which makes God to be God.
Amen.
If a person is equal to God in all things, they are God.
Yes.
For example, in Mark 14, 60-64, there is an incident at the end of Christ's earthly life in which he directly claimed to be God. And it reads as follows. The high priest stood up and came forward and questioned Jesus, saying, "Do you not answer? What is it these men are testifying against you?" But he kept silent and did not answer. Again, the high priest was questioning him and saying to him, "Are you the Christ?" In Hebrew it is, "Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?" So Caiaphas was asking Christ, was he the unique Son of the Father, unlike anyone else? He is asking him, are you really equal to God? Now, to the non-Jewish mind, and the mind which is not rooted in the Old Testament scriptures, Jesus answered Caiaphas. It might not sound as a clear affirmation that he was God incarnate. But to the Jewish mind, Jesus' statement was as clear as it could be, that he was claiming to be God incarnate, are one and the same essence and substance with God the Father in every infinite way. And I say this because the Lord's answer to Caiaphas when he says, "Tell us, are you the Messiah? Are you the Christ? Are you the Son of the Blessed One?" And that's God the Father. And the text says, and Jesus said, "I am." And so Caiaphas, he asked Christ, was he the Messiah? Was he both God and man? And the Lord says, "I am." Mm-hmm. This was a clear statement made by Christ, that he was the same God who spoke to Moses out of the burning bush in Exodus 3, 13-14. You see, it was on this occasion God revealed his name at the request of Moses. The episode reads as follows. Then Moses said to God, "Behold, I am going to the sons of Israel, and I will say to them, the God of your father that sent me to you. Now they may say to me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? God said to Moses, I am whom I am. And he said, thus you shall say to the sons of Israel, I am has sent me to you.
Amen.
So when the Lord says, I am, he was really saying quite a bit. Notice God said his name is I Am. When Jesus was asked by Caiaphas, was he the Son of God or was he equal to God? Jesus firmly answered by identifying himself as the one who said to Moses, tell the people of Israel that his name was I Am. Caiaphas the high priest, he would have known the Old Testament probably from memory, the whole thing. And thus there is no doubt he understood that Jesus was claimed to be the same God who spoke to Moses out of the burning bush, who said, my name is I Am. And so Jesus says, I am. The Lord went on to say, and you shall see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven. When Jesus identified himself as the Son of Man, this was one of the strongest claims in the Jewish mind, or a mind saturated in the Old Testament scripture, that Jesus was God in human flesh, or the God-man. And I say this because Jesus' words were a reference to the Old Testament scriptures, Daniel 7, 13 through 14, where Daniel the prophet, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, he foresaw and thus predicted the Messiah of Israel coming to judge the earth realm and to establish his kingdom. And the title Daniel uses, the Messiah, was the title the Son of Man. The title the Son of Man is the same one Jesus used of himself when he told Caiaphas who he was. And so Daniel saw the Son of Man as the one who stood before the Ancient of Days, who stood before God the Father, and this Son of Man in Daniel. He is given a dominion, glory, and a kingdom in order that all peoples, all nations, and men of every language might worship him. It was an Old Testament truth that no one could be worshipped but God.
Amen.
No one could be served in the sense of serving God but God. Amen. This was clearly revealed by God to Moses in the first of the Ten Commandments, Exodus 20, 1 through 5. Then God spoke all these words, saying, I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol or any likeness of what is in heaven, above, or on the earth, beneath, or in the water, under the earth. You shall not worship them or serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God.
Amen.
The only one in the Bible who can be worshipped is God.
Amen.
Since the Son of Man, Daniel predicted, would come to judge the earth and rule over his kingdom and would be worshipped, he had to be God.
Amen.
For only God could be worshipped.
Amen.
So that's, and by the way, that's the title Jesus used of himself more than any other. Son of Man. Now to us, it doesn't mean the same thing as it would have meant to the Jewish mind. To the Jewish mind, when the Lord kept saying over and over and over he was the Son of Man, he was really saying, I am God incarnate in human flesh. I am the Messiah of Israel. And I will establish the throne of God forever. And all the Jews knew that the Messiah would be worshipped just like God, because the Messiah would be God incarnate in human flesh.
Amen.
And so he said, you got it. I am. I am that I am. I'm the one who spoke to Moses. I am.
Son of Man, coming in all of his glory. I am the Messiah. I am the one who shall be worshipped. In verse 63 to 64, Caius, the reader Caius, responds. And the Bible says, tearing his clothes. The high priest said, what further need do you have? And they all condemned him to be deserving of death.
Come on, teach.
Unlike today when one claims to be God, or even close to being God, it was considered blasphemy. Caiaphas clearly understood Jesus claimed to be God. And therefore, he believed he had committed blasphemy. And therefore, they all believed and condemned him to be deserving of death. And so we understand Caiaphas clearly understood Jesus claimed to be God in human flesh. Caiaphas clearly understood. Christians don't, but Caiaphas, the pagan, did.
Well,
come on,
you say that again?
Come on, Jesus.
We haven't quite worked it out yet. But the pagan Caiaphas clearly understood that you are a man, but yet you are claiming to be equal with God. And so we see that Jesus in very clear terms claimed to be God in human flesh, or both God and man. But claiming to be God is not proof.
Amen.
That Jesus' claim was true. Because anyone, even an insane person, even a bishop, can claim to be God. But they cannot prove it. Therefore, Jesus had to prove it was true that he really was the Son of God, or equal to God, or God in human flesh. And he did this by being raised from the dead.
Amen.
This is what Paul states in Romans 1:1-4. Paul, a bondservant of Christ Jesus, called as an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God, which he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, concerning his son who was born of a descendant of David according to the flesh, who was declared to be the Son of God with power by the resurrection from the dead. Once again, the title Son of God. It is a title identifying one to be equal with God the Father. Jesus' bodily resurrection from the dead, a historical fact witnessed by many primary witnesses, was and is the proof that he was and he is God incarnate, God in human flesh. Jesus' bodily resurrection from the dead, it was the ultimate proof that God was one person, that Christ was one person with two distinct natures, the nature of God and the nature of a sinless human being. Now, since Jesus was and is God Almighty, equal with the Father and all that makes God to be God, since he's the only one that can say, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Mm-hmm. If the Father has life in himself, I have life in myself. Since he's the only one that can truthfully say, you believe in God, you're doing all right. Now believe also in me.
Yes, sir.
He was God in every sense of the term. Since that is who he was and is, the entirety of all that Christ says and thinks is absolutely true, with no possibility of error. Because God cannot lie. And God cannot get anything wrong in thought or deed.
Amen.
Therefore, all which Jesus the God-man believed to be true concerning the scriptures, it is the only view that counts because it is the view of God. Amen.
Amen.
His view is the view of God. Because that's who he is.
Amen.
What that says is that's the only view that counts.
Amen.
Let God be true and everybody else a lie. The viewpoint of God is infinitely true. And it renders the views and opinions of all those to be absolutely See, this is why we need to understand what Jesus believed to be true concerning the scriptures. For if we can believe the same thing Jesus believed concerning the scriptures, we will believe what God believed.
Amen. Amen.
About the scriptures. For Jesus was and is God in human flesh.
Amen.
To believe what Jesus believed about the scriptures is to believe the same thing God believed about the scriptures.
Amen.
Now, I don't think you can go no higher than that. Amen.
Amen.
Let it be. It is important that we Christian believers possess an adequate understanding of what Jesus believed to be true about the scriptures, because what some men and women believe about the scriptures is either partly true or wholly wrong. We need to understand what Christ believed about scripture, because what some men and women believe about the scriptures is either partly true or wholly wrong. If we believe what these particular men or women believe to be true about the scriptures, our view of the scriptures will either be partly true, which also means it's partly wrong. Or we will believe that which is wholly wrong concerning the scriptures. And neither of these views can bring about any good in the life of a Christian or the life of the church. And what I mean by this is the following. Right now, as we live, as I stand and breathe, there are four basic beliefs men and women have today concerning the scriptures. They are as follows. The 39 books of the Old Testament and the 27 books of the New Testament are the inerrant word of God. When I use the term inerrant in reference to the scriptures, what I mean is that the Holy Scriptures, both Old and New Testaments, are wholly or entirely true in all that they proclaim, no matter the subject matter.
Amen.
This includes statements regarding matters of salvation, matters concerning the necessary doctrine of the church which must be believed in order to be saved, matters concerning the doctrine necessary to live a fruitful Christian life, and all other matters, even statements about history and science. When we say the Bible is inerrant, what we mean is what God says in His Word about all of these things is wholly true.
Amen.
Amen.
Well, so we believe that the Bible is wholly true.
100%.
Amen.
In the United States, theologians call this the belief in the inerrancy of the Scriptures. Conservative theologians in Europe, there are a few of them, they call this the full authority of God through the Scriptures. Both mean the same thing. But personally, I like to combine both together to develop a most comprehensive definition of the right way to view the Scriptures. And it goes like this. The Scriptures are entirely true in all they proclaim, and thus they bear the full authority of God. The technical name of this belief in the Scriptures is orthodoxy. Somebody say amen today.
Amen. Amen. The knowledge of the Scripture.
I don't know if we know what that word means anymore. Ortho what? Orthodoxy. We believe the Bible is wholly true. Now, we need to find out what Jesus believed to be true about the Scriptures in order that we are encouraged to continue in this position without any compromise. For I really believe this is the same view Jesus had of the Scriptures. He was orthodox in his view of the Scripture.
Amen.
Jesus believed the Scriptures were wholly true. Then number two, there are some whose view of the Scriptures is partly true. But the converse or the opposite of that is also true. That is, if what one believes about the Scriptures is partly true, then some of what they believe is partly false. And any time you have a false belief in the things of God, and this is especially true concerning the Holy Scriptures, this is never good. And therefore, the results are never good, but always something bad. Now, believing something partly true about the Bible, I think it is true in two specific groups. Let me give you both of them. Number one, there are some, and they are primarily theologians and scholars in Europe, who are wholly committed to belief in the full authority of God through the scriptures concerning matters of salvation, all the miracles recorded in the scriptures, all what the scriptures teach concerning the necessary doctrine of the faith. They are wholly committed to the virgin birth. They are wholly committed to the incarnation of the Son of God. They believe, they are wholly committed to the bodily resurrection of Jesus from the dead. They are wholly committed to the reality of the Holy Spirit indwelling every believer. And they are wholly committed to the return of Christ for his church, for all who know Christ as Savior. And they are firmly committed to the ethics and morality taught in the scriptures. In other words, if you ask them, do they believe the biblical truth that adultery or homosexuality is sin? They will say yes. But they doubt some of the historical references in the scriptures to be accurate.
Come on, teach, Pastor.
And they doubt some of the statements in the scripture concerning matters of science to be accurate. Now, they do not believe the authors of the scriptures deliberately attempted to deceive any by writing these inaccuracies, but they believe they were simply echoing some of the ignorances of their day in these things. These particular theologians slash Christians believe, since the ultimate reason God gave the scripture was to give believers certainty in matters of salvation, doctrine, and how to live the Christian life, they believe God inspired the authors inerrantly or wholly true in these matters, but not in matters not necessary for salvation and living the Christian life. And this includes some of the historical references and some of the matters of science in the Bible. The term for this is neo-orthodoxy, meaning the new orthodox. Now, I want to make it very plain that this is not my point of view concerning the scriptures and how God would judge these who believe this concerning the scriptures. Only God alone knows what he will judge or assess of them when they stand before him to give an account. But I'm being honest this morning, in spite of all of that. I have read the theologies of some of these neo-orthodox theologians, and I do believe they are genuinely saved. I do believe they have genuinely been saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. I also believe a Christian would be much better off sitting under the teaching of the neo-orthodox than in some of these churches that have fallen prey to strange, charismatic fire.
Amen.
And those in which the bishop has set itself up as some kind of sovereign king whose word is equal or elevated above the scriptures. Be that as it may, in the long run, I do not believe the neo-orthodox view of the scripture is good. For how can you be dogmatic in your doctrine and matters concerning salvation in the presence of an unbelieving world when your source for truth in these things contains inaccuracies?
Come on, teach. Come on, Pastor, teach.
That's the problem with me.
Amen.
This belief is a slippery slope to compromise other things in the Holy Scriptures, which the world right now does not want to accept because of so-called scientific discoveries. So, you know, you open up the door. There are some who believe Paul did not understand the science behind men being attracted to men. And they say science is proven now that, you know, they got chromosome problems. Send the genes. don't mean blue jeans, it's any jeans. And they said Paul didn't understand that back then, he was being honest and true, but we now know that, you know, some are born with this whatever. And so it has led some to say we accept this part of the Bible, but we don't accept that one part Paul said that it's a vow. Affection.
Well,
see, and this is the downward result of not believing the scriptures are wholly true.
Yes.
In all areas.
Amen.
And so I do believe in the long run, this view produces great spiritual damage in the church and in the lives of individual believers. There is another sector of the church which claims to believe the Bible is wholly true, yet they don't believe it is enough. And this is why they say we need ongoing revelation from God. Or they supplement the Holy Scriptures with their so-called words they say they have received directly from God. This often comes across through the phrase, the Lord told me such and such. And even though it's not in the scripture, you had better listen, because if you don't, you are blaspheming the Holy Ghost.
Well,
it is one of the, yea, I say to you, my children, statements. Thus saith the Lord, thus saith the Lord. That is often indicative of strange fire, charismatic chaos.
Well,
diaper service. The truth is, if God has given you a word that is not in the scriptures, then we must admit the scriptures are lacking. L-A-C-K-I-N-D, they are lacking as being sufficient for all things related to the faith which is in Christ. If God got to get a word to you through me that's not in this book, then we are admitting this book is not sufficient.
Amen. Come on, teach.
To meet every need.
Teach us.
In life. If the scriptures do not contain all which the believer needs to live the Christian life, therefore God has given additional revelation. How do we determine which so-called word is true and which one is false? You cannot.
Amen.
Because if the scriptures don't contain everything you need, then you can't search the scriptures daily to see whether what is being said is true.
Right.
I mean, if I'm giving you a word from the Lord that's not in the Bible, you can't search the scriptures to see whether it is false or true.
Right?
And here we go again. Now you have the Bible not being sufficient. Now, I believe this position is far worse than the neo-Orthodox. For at least the neo-Orthodox do believe the scriptures contain all necessary to be saved and live the Christian life. At least the neo-Orthodox position, and I don't share that, it enables one to search the scriptures to see whether what is being said is true as far as all spiritual things. People who are caught up into this type of belief about the Holy Scriptures, I'm getting a word from the Lord. Y'all close your Bibles up. Wait a minute. Which is the way a pagan priest used to act in the temple. And the witch doctor still acts in the village like he out of his mind. And here comes a word from the Lord. The problem is you really don't believe what Jesus believed to be true concerning the scriptures.
Amen.
If you believe you need to get a supplement, then you do not believe what Jesus believed to be true.
Amen.
About the scriptures.
Amen.
Because he believed they were sufficient.
Yes.
And he read it this morning. Man does not live by bread alone, but by what? Every word
from the mouth of God.
Out of the mouth of God. Now that's what Jesus believed.
Yes.
There are many who are liberal theologians who profess to be Christian, but they believe the Bible is not the word of God, but it is a record of men and women's experience with God. For they believe the Bible is a record of the experience of men in their sincere quest to find and know God. If this is true, then the scripture is not the word from the mouth of God. But they are the mere word of men, even though they may have been sincere in their quest for God. Now what that means is, it's not the word of God at all, it's the word of men. We need to understand that this is true. If this is what is true about the scripture, then what Jesus believed about the scriptures is false. And if what the Lord believes about the scriptures is false, he cannot be who he claimed to be. We need to understand the truth, then we need to understand this, that we don't need anything to supplement
the word of God.
The scriptures. Amen?
Amen.
All right, now that we have seen why we must understand why Jesus, what Jesus believed to be true about the scriptures is necessary, I want to turn our attention to the four Gospels. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Because they tell us what Jesus believed to be true about the scriptures. Now, I know I've been a little bit academic this morning, but I must do this to get to where I'm going.
Amen.
First of all, I was teaching a group of students in an academic setting. The first thing I would do before looking at both the Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and also John, before I would look at what they say in relationship to what Jesus believed about the scriptures, the first thing I would establish is are these books or documents historically reliable? Because if they're not historically reliable, then we can't trust what they say Jesus believed to be true about the scriptures.
Amen.
Now, I'm not going to labor in this point because that's not my series. I could, but that's not my series. But suffice it to say that the four Gospels have been proven to be historically reliable. They perfectly fit the period in which they were written. Archaeologists have proven them to be true over and over and over and over and over.
Amen.
The more we dig up and the more we learn, the only thing we're learning is just how accurate those New Testament writers really were. And what these historically accurate documents teach us is this. In the mind of Jesus, the scriptures were the word of God.
Amen.
In the mind of Jesus, the God revealed in what we call the Old Testament, the true and the living God. The teaching of what we call the Old Testament was what God taught. Jesus believed that that's what God taught. In the mind of our Lord, to listen to the scriptures was exactly the same as listening to the voice of God. Jesus believed what the scriptures said is what God said.
Amen.
All right.
That's where we need to be.
Mm-hmm.
We must also understand that during Jesus' day, what we presently call the Old Testament, it was not looked upon as the Old Testament. You must understand the term Old Testament in description of all the books in the Bible written before Jesus' earthly ministry. It was never called by Jesus the Old Testament. It was simply called the Scriptures. In my opinion, the best name for both Old and New Testaments is simply called the Scriptures. Because when we start saying Old, sort of signifies something that's archaic, old, stale, dusty, has no present significance. You know, when young folks call you old, that's not a compliment. You need to know that, elderly folks. When a guy 25 says, "Are you old, Pastor Keller?" That's not a compliment. What are you trying to tell me? I don't know what I'm talking about. Are you old? Even though I've been there, done that, a whole lot of times, he tried to tell me what I don't know. And you ain't even made your first mortgage payment yet. You trying to tell me. said, you need to understand, that's a term we came up with. Jesus never used that. He just called it the scriptures. This is not true, for as we shall see, Jesus said, not one word of what we call the Old Testament, but ever pass away until everything is fulfilled. As a matter of fact, Jesus said not one jot or tittle. It's like saying not one comma in the Bible will pass away until everything in what we call the Old Testament is fulfilled. Guess what? Not everything in the Old Testament has been fulfilled. Therefore, what we call the Old Testament just as relevant today as it was 2,500 years ago, or when God gave the last book to Malachi.
Amen.
The Lord said, it's not going to pass away until everything has been fulfilled. Yes. Everything has not been fulfilled.
Amen.
Right. Therefore, some stuff in there for us today, it is still relevant for us today.
Well, hallelujah. Amen.
It's just the scriptures.
Come on, T.
I don't like this old and new. Because in our mind, new is better.
Come on, teach.
It is. That's what it means. Oh, that's the old way.
Come on, teach us how to think. Come on.
It's the new way we do it. See, old is bad, new is good. And I know we don't need to do this, but it really works itself out that way in our mind.
How we
that's why preachers say, oh, that's the Old Testament.
Teach us.
Amen.
That was the Old Testament. God was killing people. I mean, God killed some folks today. I'm serious.
Good stuff, Pastor. Teach. Excellent.
I love James Bond. And in the James Bond Skyfall, remember they had all these sophisticated weapons. It's coming in with helicopters and all kinds of stuff. You know, Bond, all that sophisticated gadgetry. And the old man came in with the long coat. He showed him all his firepower. You remember that? And he pulled out a little knife and laid it on the table and said, sometimes the old ways were best. Because the old is always relevant.
Amen.
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 Amen. Yeah, I'm old, young folks, but I know more than you, so I'm relevant to you. Amen. Let me move on.
Okay. Amen. Wisdom. Come on.
It is odd, but nevertheless true, that the way we come to understand what Jesus believed about the scriptures, it's not revealed in any specific systematic teaching he gave to his disciples. In other words, Jesus never gave his disciples a systematic theology lesson. He never gave them a lesson point by point and said, this is my bibliology, guys. He never laid out point by point, this is why the Bible is the word of God. He never did that. To the contrary, we can clearly see what Jesus believed to be true in regard to Scripture through his natural assumptions about the Scriptures. We can see throughout the four Gospels that Jesus naturally assumed, apart from any questions or doubts or reservations, that the Scriptures truly were the Word of God. What the Scripture said is what God said. We can discern this fact in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. As we see Jesus preaching to the multitudes, it was always saturated with allusions or direct quotes from what we call the Old Testament, or what I just call the Scriptures. Now, Jesus is quoting the Old Testament. So if he's quoting that, how is it relevant today?
Amen.
Amen.
I thought every word came out of Jesus' mouth was relevant.
Yes.
Well, amen. So if he's quoting what we call the old, how is it not good for us today? Ain't nothing back in there, Pastor. Yes, it is. Whole lot in there keep you out of jail. That's my skill, amen. Christ saved following this 40-day fast. The scriptures say he returned to his hometown of Nazareth. He went into his local synagogue. Be like him coming back home, coming to his local church. And the episode reads as follows in Luke 4, 16 to 21. And he came to Nazareth where he had been brought up. And as was his custom, he entered the synagogue on the Sabbath and stood up to read. And the book of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him.
Amen.
And he opened the book and found the place. He was deliberate. He deliberately went to Isaiah 61. And he began to read, the Bible says. And he read this: the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and the recovery of sight to the blind, to set free those who are oppressed, to proclaim the favorable year of the Lord. And so he actually read Isaiah 61, 1 through 2. And it goes on to say, and he closed the book, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. And the eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. And he began to say to them, today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing.
Amen. Hallelujah.
The fact that Jesus said he was fulfilling this Isaiah text reveals he believed and bore the full weight of the authority of God. See, if he didn't believe that's what it was, he never would have said, I'm fulfilling it.
Amen.
He believed it was what God said. Therefore, I am fulfilling what God said. He believed that Old Testament that we call it bore the full authority of God.
Amen. 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 Wonderful.
We can see Jesus believe what the scripture said was what God said through the fact that he often refuted his enemies by quoting or alluding to the scriptures as bearing the full authority of God. For example, in John 6, 41 through 45, Jesus confronted those who were grumbling at him. He confronted them with the scriptures. He quoted Isaiah 54, 13, therefore the Jews were grumbling about him because he said, I am the bread come down out of heaven. Jesus answered and said to them, do not grumble among yourselves. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him. And I will raise him up on the last day. And he says, it is written in the prophets, and they shall be taught of God. That's Isaiah 54, 13. Everyone has heard and learned from the Father. So he quotes Isaiah 54 and 13 to his enemies.
Amen.
Why? Because he knew that text, it bore the full authority
of God.
Amen.
Amen.
We see Jesus, the Word of God incarnate, answering the questions of those who ask him questions through the scriptures. The rich young ruler asked the Lord what he needed to do to earn eternal life. It's amazing Jesus took him right to scripture. Exodus 20, he gave him several of the Ten Commandments. Text says the ruler questioned him, good teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus said to him, why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments, do not commit adultery, do not murder, do not steal, do not bear false witness. Honor your father and mother. Jesus answered these young men through the word of the scripture revealed. He believed they bore the full authority of God. If Jesus did not believe that text bore the full authority of God, there's no reason for him to point the rich young ruler to it.
Amen.
Now we have God pointing a man to the scriptures. Why? Because God believed the scripture was what God really said. And I'm trying to ascertain, is that what we really believe about the word of God? I'm not supposed to be hard at this teacher.
It's beautiful, Pastor. Beautiful.
We can see what Jesus believed to be true concerning the scriptures at the beginning of his ministry. As he confronted Satan with the scriptures. We just read it in our sermon text. He said to the devil, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. And he said, it is written. It's written. And so Jesus believed what was written was what God really said. And he believed it bore the full, not half, not three quarter, not 99.9, he believed it bore the full authority of God. How much time? Let me let you have a little secret.
Take your time.
You know, when Jesus went to the synagogue, and they gave him a scroll of Isaiah, that scroll was not the original document. It was a copy. But Jesus still read it.
Come on, teach.
And believe the full glory of God is in it. What's that say to us? What that says is, this is not the original.
Right.
It's a copy. But God has seen to it
preserved
that this happened represents.
Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Because he holds all things together, amen.
Jesus is saying that the original was true and the copy is also God has preserved it.
Amen.
That's just all you keep.
Amen. Yeah. Because Christ holds all things together, amen.
Hold up.
Amen.
Now let me say this and I'm going to move on.
Teach us.
I hope you'll understand what I'm going to say.
Come on, God.
Preach,
it's probably a good thing that God did not preserve the original writing.
Amen. Worshiping it.
Let me tell you why. Because we'd be worshiping it.
Yep. Yep. Idolatry.
Our DNA. Got Aaron's rod that put it. Set it up as an idol.
He loves an idol.
And the king had to break it to pieces. See, it's the authority of God through the scripture.
Amen. Amen.
This is just ink and paper and leather. So we're not worshiping the leather of this Bible. We're not worshiping the paper in this Bible. But we worship the God who gave us this Bible. And the thing is, the words there,
come on,
they came from God.
God
and so we worship God because he has given us and preserved from us an inerrant word of God. Amen.
Yeah, good stuff, Pastor. Good stuff. Beautiful.
We can see what Jesus believed to be true about the scriptures at the end of his ministry. It's amazing. He began his ministry with the word of God.
Closed it out.
And ended it with the word of God. And Judas betrayed him, and the Jews arrested him. He pointed all of them back to the scripture.
Amen.
Matthew 26, 55, 56. At that time, Jesus said to the crowds, have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as you would against a robber? Every day I used to sit in the temple teaching, and you did not see me. And the Lord said this to them, all this has taken place to fulfill the scriptures of the prophets. Then all his disciples left him. The fact that Christ believed he was fulfilling the scriptures, even through his betrayal and arrest, reveals he believed those scriptures bore the full authority of God. He believed what the scriptures said is what God said, and therefore he fulfilled them.
Amen.
Amen.
Even on the cross, the Lord was violent.
Amen.
He cried out, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. He's quoting Psalm 22 in 1. It literally reads, my God, why have you forsaken me? So we even see while on the cross, he still believed what the scripture said is what God said.
Harmony, amen. Harmony. Amen.
At the beginning, he's quoting scripture all through the and everything in between there, he's quoting scripture.
Yes.
He's about to get arrested, he's still quoting scripture. He's on the cross, he's still quoting scripture. Are you with me today? Oh, guess what? After he rose from the dead, he was still quoting scripture.
Hallelujah. Yes. Amen.
After he had been crucified and put to death, he rose from the dead. Met a couple of boys on the road to a mess.
Amen.
And they were telling how down, trying to, Jesus, we thought he was the one, we thought he was the Messiah, we thought he was going to restore the kingdom and get the Romans off our back.
Well,
and then crucify him and they killed the dead, don't raise. And they're just talking, and the Bible says Jesus His appearance was kind of veiled. And I don't want to get too deeply in this, but I could. Another serious, but after Christ rose from the dead, it seems he was his physicality was somewhat changed. Mm-hmm. They knew it was him, but different. And the Bible implies in the Greek that whenever he showed up, they just looked at him. They hadn't really. He was the same.
That glorified body.
But changed. Mm-hmm. And the Bible says we shall all be changed.
Amen.
That's something that's unusual. But they didn't really know it was him. And so as they're walking along, the Lord said to them, and he said to them, O foolish men, and slow of heart to believe all that the prophet has spoken. Was it not necessary for Christ to suffer these things and to enter into his glory? Then beginning with Moses and with all the prophets, he explained to them the things concerning himself in all the scripture.
Amen.
After Jesus rose from the dead, he still believed the scriptures.
Amen.
For the full authority
Amen.
Of God.
Amen.
Now, if God can quote scripture, why can't you?
Amen.
Now, if God can quote the scriptures as the full authority of God, what's wrong with you that you don't want to hear? But you'd rather hear some silly bishop with a talk show. Somebody say amen.
Amen. Come on, cut it straight.
As I read through the scriptures, the gospels, it appears to me that Jesus quoted scriptures more than any other person in the Word of God. Jesus' thinking was saturated with the scriptures during his sojourn here on the earth. And he didn't change. Even after his resurrection, he was still saturated. But it is written. Amen?
Amen.
Now I'm going to sit down. Is this what you believe about the scriptures? Do you believe the scriptures are holy, true, and thus they bear the full authority of God? If you do, you believe the same thing Jesus believed about the scriptures. And that is what the scripture says is what God said. You cannot go any higher than disbelief and trust in the word of God.
Amen.
If you do not believe the scriptures bear the full authority of God, you do not believe the same thing Jesus believed about the scriptures, and you are headed down the wrong path.
Amen.
Does your church believe what Jesus believed about the scriptures? Does your church believe that bear the full authority of God? If you do belong to a church like that, you belong to a church which believes the same thing Jesus believed about the scriptures. If you go to a church where the scriptures are denigrated and have been reduced to dusty old 3,000-year-old revelation, you walk in there and the words of the king, I mean the bishop of that place, I thought to say king, his words all, y'all laughing, his words all up on the wall. So-and-so said this, so-and-so said this, so-and-so said this, his picture's up, and all this other kind of nonsense.
Run.
You're going to a church that does not believe what Jesus believed about the scriptures. That is what they said is what God said. And I'm just saying, now you're in the wrong church. And you should run for your life. Does your pastor believe what Jesus believed to be true about the scriptures? That is, does he believe they bear the full authority of God? If he does, he believes the same thing Jesus believes about the scriptures. If on the other hand, he believes your problem is you read too much Bible. But he commands you to believe every word he said without question. Your pastor does not believe what Jesus believed to be true about the scriptures. This, of course, is he does not believe the scriptures bear the full authority of God. What the scripture said is what God said. If that is what your pastor believes about the scriptures, then you are being led down the wrong path of instruction, and you should run for your spiritual life.
Amen.
By leaving that congregation, and don't look back.
Amen.
Anybody with me today?
Amen. Amen.
Let me stop. I'm through. Some of y'all are not. Let's pray. Come on. We praise you and thank you for all things today. Lord, these were just some introductory things. As
begin this journey of trying to discover what our Lord believed to be true about the scriptures. Lord, let us follow in his footsteps, for he is the ultimate example of who we should be in our relationship to God. Lord, I pray that everybody in here today learns this simple phrase. Jesus believed what the scripture said is what God said. And therefore, they, all of them, bear the full authority of God. Jesus believed you can live by every scripture because it proceeds out of the mouth of God. Lord, let us have the same view of the scriptures as Jesus did. Lord, help us to remember, and I understand we say Old Testament and New Testament for reference sake. I understand that, but let us not be hung up on old and new, because in our mind, one signifies better than the other. It's just the scriptures, and they are from God. And all of them is what God actually said. Amen?
Amen.
Lord, I pray that as believers we develop this view of our Bibles. Is there one today you do not know Jesus Christ? You just say it. If you're out there in YouTube land, live stream, wherever you're at, life is short.
Yes, yes.
We don't know what a day may bring. And if you don't know Christ as your Savior, wherever eternity finds you, that's where it'll keep you. If you enter into eternity not on Jesus Christ, your eternity will be separated from God.
Amen.
In the place of Jesus, we call hell, out of darkness, weeping, wailing, gnashing of teeth. A fire that never shall be quenched. Now that's what Jesus called it. The only way to escape that eternity and to spend your eternity in the local presence of God, eventually be raised up in a new body, just like the one Jesus said after he rose from the dead, and be with him forever in the new heaven and new earth. The only way to have that eternity is through repentance of your sin. Look at your life. Be honest. My life is sinful, my life is raggedy, my life is filthy in thought, word, and deed. Confess that sin to God. Repent. Turn to Jesus Christ, turn to God, and ask God to save you. And believe that he died for your sins. He was buried, and he rose again. Ask Christ to your life. Trust in him, and him alone, and his sufficiency to save you from all of your sins. If you do that, the Bible promises you, you shall be saved.
Amen.
So if you're out there today, tell God you're sorry for your sins, truly turn to his Son as your Savior, and believe that he died, was buried, and rose again, and God promised you that he will save your soul forever. Perhaps there's one in this building today who do not know Jesus Christ. It is by grace and faith that we are saved. There's one today, and you want to respond to the gospel, would you just raise your hand today? Father God, I praise you and thank you for all things today. Lord, help us to understand the simple message of the gospel, that it is the only message that saves from sin. Lord, I pray for every individual in this room today, everybody out there in live stream, whatever your need is, God is greater than the need.
Yes.
God can make a way.
Amen.
And so we ask God to give you exactly what you need at the right time, at the right moment, and in the right amount. Father God, I praise you and thank you for all things today. We pray in Jesus' name. Let God's name say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Give God a hand.